2016 has a reputation.
Dropped out of school, now we done rich.
Slow, moody, dark, depressing. Words that often come to mind when thinking about the charts in 2016. Trends set in motion as early as 2013 completed their takeover and dug in their heels for the rest of the decade. Trap almost completely devoured the hip-hop scene, while pop spent the entire year trying to reverse engineer Lorde's success and mostly fell flat on its face in the process. And that the gloomy 2016 immediately followed the fantastic and upbeat 2015 only made that contrast even sharper. So yeah, 2016, it ain't well liked, and there's a reason for that. We're not here to talk about that though. While 2016 as a whole could accurately be described as below average, it had more than its fair share of gems to balance it out. Some leaned into this year's nihilistic tendencies, while others stood in defiance against the call of the void. It's not a year like the dreadful 2018 where I struggled to even fill a top 10. No, in fact, picking which 10 songs would make this list was easier than it's ever been. And every song that made the cut is genuinely great, which I can't say about all my previous best lists either. Yeah, maybe it doesn't reach the same phenomenal highs as other years have, but this is still a damn strong set of songs that I'm more than proud to present to y'all. But before we begin, the rules. Same as usual, songs had to debut on the Billboard year-end for 2016 to be eligible, so all of these songs are ineligible. Dear Lord, that's a lot of them. Huh. Well, anyways, this is the top 10 best hit songs of 2016. Number 10. I'm a motherfucking star boy. Don't let me down. I've given EDM a lot of crap. For many reasons, tedious repetition, flat or even painful drops, the anonymity a lot of it projects, but more than anything, it's for lacking emotional depth. It just doesn't make me feel anything. No sadness, no joy, no regret, no fun, nothing. And it's funny I can say that considering we all know there's a song that exists solely to disprove that very notion. I took a pill in Ibiza to show Avicii I was cool. That this song is on the list is probably not surprising. That it barely squeezed onto the list, maybe more so. I'm surprised too, honestly. This song is really good. Frankly, these first six entries are all basically tied. This could be at like number 5 or number 6 and not feel misplaced. And some of the songs I put above this are gonna land me in a world of trouble too, but we'll cross that bridge when we get there. Ooh, I know a sad soul. As for the song itself, I Took a Pill in Ibiza by Mike Posner. The song about how much it sucks to be a one-hit wonder, remixed by a Norwegian dance act to become his second and biggest hit. And it stands out so much because there isn't really any other song like it, is there? Maybe if you squint at it, Billy Ray Cyrus' verse on Old Town Road counts? Probably not. I get along with old timers, cause my name's a reminder of a pop song people forget. What makes the song work so well is twofold. First, the lyrics themselves. Posner's laments about how all his money and fame earned him jack squat but depression. That goddamn Avicii line sets the tone immediately, and it just doesn't let up from there. Every single line is a home run straight to the heart. You don't wanna ride the bus like this. Never know who to trust like this. Of course, his words would mean nothing if not paired with Seeb's club-ready yet equally bleak production. The two of which go together so seamlessly, it's not hard to forget that this was originally a sad boy acoustic ballad that actually doesn't exist. It doesn't exist! I've never listened to it, I know. The song needed a club atmosphere to work, and Seeb delivered. And I know I complained about EDM drops in my preamble, but... God, this drop hits so hard. It sounds absolutely pristine and, more importantly, hopeless. but everything I just said, you probably already knew. Hell, this is probably the most well-liked and talked about hit of the year. If anything, I should be defending why it's so low here. Well, mostly just stiff competition, and a few nitpicks. I can't say I personally relate to it, but then I've loved plenty of songs I don't relate to, so that can't be the only thing. It's a bit short, could've used a bridge maybe, I don't know. That's about all I got, really. A minor gripe and a personal quibble. Song's just good, yo. Number 8. Whoa, one at a time, lads. So yeah, Coldplay had 2 year-end hits in 2016, and both were really good. I could've easily tied them, but I don't like ties, so we're compromising and giving them both a joint 9th and 8th place. Mostly because I can't really tell you which one I like more. Like, they're kind of similar songs, but they're also not that similar. Him is more classically Coldplay, with its bombastic horns and its more languid pacing. A perfect fit for 2016's downbeat atmosphere. Meanwhile, Adventure is more of a 2015 hit. It's upbeat, it's bright, and it's groovy as heck. Yet, it still sounds definitively Coldplay, mostly thanks to Chris Martin's distinct voice soaring all over the track. Speaking of voices, the one other big thing him has going for it are the uncredited vocals from Beyoncé of all people, which confuses me. Not her presence though. If there's one thing to say about Beyoncé, it's that she's always willing to take risks. Be it atonal oral disasters, black empowerment anthems, confused dance numbers, or trashing her billionaire husband, she's got a pattern of doing whatever the hell she wants, and I respect the hell out of that. Yet, being featured on a Coldplay track is the one thing she doesn't want to hurt. Name? I don't get it. None of that really matters since she is here and she sounds wonderful. The whole song sounds wonderful, really. Martin and Beyoncé have great vocal chemistry. The bouncy piano and percussion pair well for a laid-back but never slow-paced groove, and the song balances its orchestral bombast with its rock instruments well enough that neither ever overpowers the other. Everything fits together so neatly, and it builds to one hell of a climax. All that is more than enough to paint over just how basic and frankly unremarkable the lyrics are, which like, yeah, it's pretty much just basic love cliches, but again, who cares? The chorus can be the same line repeated over and over, and I'll still be compelled to sing along to it each and every time. It's wonderfully anthemic. Turn your magical. As for Adventure, it's, well, also a bit of a cliched love song, though there's a bit more to it than him, but I gotta be honest, for the longest time I was mishearing some of these lyrics, and the song was better for it. Like, the second verse, for example. Said I can't go on, not in this way. I'm a dream to die by light of day. Those misheard lines alone turned the whole song from a your love saves me type affair to a more tragic story. We've been on the adventure of a lifetime together, but that was a dream that couldn't last forever. Yet, we're still going to celebrate what we had and keep on living in spite of it all. Of course, that's not what the lines actually are, but honestly, it hardly matters anyways. And like with him, this song just sounds wonderful. The bassline is the star of the show for me here. What a groove, man. Though the drums really help to back up that groove as well. But then, of course, there's that iconic guitar line, which... Yeah, that one. Incredibly sticky, incredibly colorful, incredibly iconic. And the song just has a great build throughout and one hell of a fun payoff. Oh, Most everything else the songs have in common is actually what kept them from placing any higher. They're both good, fun songs that sound great, but I can't say either of them mean much to me, make me feel anything particularly strong, and neither of them are really ambitious. They're not the next Viva La Vida, to say the least. As for which is better, yeah, my mind's still not made up there either. Him sounds better in my head, but Adventure is the one I enjoy more when actually listening to both, and has the slight edge lyrically too. But mostly, it just depends on my mood. Feeling mellow or tired, Him fits my mood better. Feeling more energetic, Adventure all the way. They'll probably just go back and forth forever, hence why I'm tying but not really tying them here and calling it a day. I mean, it's two great songs for the price of one. What's there to complain about? That was you. Number 7. The way people use the word simple when describing music often feels derogatory, unjustly so. Simple songs can be really good. Simple songs can be really damn good. And complex multi-movement epics aren't automatically great either. Like, yeah, songs can be too basic to the point of inanity, but there can be a beauty in simplicity, sometimes more than you'd ever expect to find. So come on, let it go. Just let it be. I already know this is going to be my least popular pick for this list, especially considering what I've ranked it over, but honestly, I almost placed it even higher, so count your blessings, it's only number 7. But really, I get it. This is a very basic song, generic even, I won't deny that. But I just really enjoy how it sounds. In the same way that I enjoy Memories by Maroon 5, but honestly, I like this one even more. For starters, that guitar motif is just really pleasant and really memorable too. Not every one of these kinds of ballads has a foundation that strong. I also like the way the gentle percussion kicks in on the second verse. From throwing clothes across the floor. It's a really satisfying rhythm to my ears. The pre-chorus is also just really beautiful. I was sleeping at the edge, holding something we don't need. Like, something about that chord progression just hits hard, man. I don't know, there's really not much I can do to explain why I love this song besides just plenty of things about it that make me happy, but I don't know if there's much to explain anyways. It's just nice, but like, in a sad way. Trying to fit your hand inside mine, when we know it just don't. Which, yeah, there's a fairly miserable aura around the whole thing, and the lyrics, while nothing groundbreaking, sell that bitterness and regret regardless. I particularly like this line from the second pre-chorus. I used to recognize myself, it's funny how reflections change. But like, the whole song does a good job painting a picture of a budding love that started to wither and rot, and a realization that they should cut things off before it destroys them both. And Bae's performance does well to sell his regret. Nothing over dramatic, but still emotive enough to sell his anguish. Come on, let it go. Just let it be. Its simplicity helps make it as effective as it is. I can't imagine adding more bells, whistles, or poetic language would really improve it in any way. Is it a flawless song? Nah. Is it particularly meaningful or impactful? Not really, no. But I'd be lying to myself if I didn't admit I love it anyways. It makes me feel what the previous few songs on this list couldn't, and for that alone, I can't help but commend it. Number 6. The man known as the King of Pop has become a tricky individual to talk about in recent years. An undeniable legacy, more all-time classics than most artists could ever dream of having, but also decades of scandals and abuse allegations, which does taint that legacy a little. Rather than get into all that, let's talk about his modern-day successor instead. I can feel my face when I'm with you. I mean, The Weeknd did rise to fame by following in Jackson's footsteps, and considering he's now the proud owner of the most successful song in Billboard history, I don't think it's unfair to call him the modern-day king of pop, even if he's a very different type of artist than Jackson ever was. Darker, more hedonistic, and unafraid to explore the traumatic aftermath of the same abuses the former king of pop was accused of. Before I go any further, content warning. Sexual abuse, child abuse. Skip to the timestamp on screen if these topics make you uncomfortable. Yeah, if I'm to have any meaningful discussion on this song, we need to establish what it's about first. It's not hard to put together. Hell, the core of the story is captured in just 3 short lines. The woman described in the song was raped, as a child even, by a man. A famous man. So famous that his music is played while she dances at a strip club, forcing her to relive that same trauma night after night, because dancing is her only means of surviving in the cold, unforgiving city. Meanwhile, the man who ruined her life is still successful to this day, with no repercussions for his actions. And while, yes, in this song, this is a story, it's not far removed from reality for many victims of childhood sexual abuse. And that the song focuses almost entirely on the victim rather than the abuser makes it stand out from others tackling similar themes. Which, when you think about it, even in real life sexual abuse cases, it's rare the victims are the focus of the conversation. There's always a crowd weaponizing the victim's experiences solely to see someone powerful fail, to bask in the schadenfreude of it. But those same people couldn't care less about how the victims feel. But that's the role The Weeknd tries to play in this song, the sympathetic part-time lover, and to be honest, I'm not sure he nails it. It's nice that you don't mind that she's a stripper, Abel. I'm not sure why that matters. I have to assume the repeated is directed at The Weeknd himself because, yeah, it doesn't quite seem like he understands either. Maybe that's the point. Maybe he couldn't possibly understand what she's going through, and that's normal. But he hardly plays any role in his own song, and it creates a weird emotional disconnect. Granted, that's not the only disconnect I feel towards this song, since, well. Try not to abuse your power. Like I've previously discussed regarding Your Power, another song about, underage relations, I can recognize the song's weight, what it means to Billie herself, but I can't relate to it in any way, nor do I want to. And In the Night isn't even personal for Abel in the same way, which keeps me yet another layer emotionally detached. Like, gonna be real here, nothing I've talked about, the song's story, its real-life implications, none of that is why I love the song. If anything, it's what kept the song this low. No. I love this song because it sounds goddamn incredible. The Weeknd has consistently had some of the most immaculate production in the mainstream, and this song is a prime example. The steady, rollicking groove, the haunting, atmospheric synths, and above all else, one of The Weeknd's best ever performances. It's the exact kind of song you'd expect to be playing within the story itself. Upbeat and danceable, tons of pop appeal, yet dark and bassy enough to be a perfect fit for a strip club. The song just sounds too damn excellent for me to deny. Like, I respect what The Weeknd attempted here. It's a compelling take on abuse and one that wasn't handled poorly, but more often than not, I'd rather just shut off my brain and jam along to the music. Maybe that makes me part of the problem too. Eh. I don't think you understand. Look what you've done. Number 5. I'm a motherfucking star boy. It took me way too long to really get into Ariana Grande's music. Like, she's been a mainstay in the mainstream since at least 2013, but it wasn't until her late 2018 hits that I really got on board with her. She's always been a consistently frustrating artist to follow, but it's hard to deny her sheer talent and flexibility as a performer. And doing these retrospective lists has really helped me appreciate some of her songs that didn't click with me at first. And thank God for that, because I'm so into this song. This one, I mean. Like, how could I not be? It's handily the best rock song of the year, including from the actual rock band I already put on this list. Like, I get why Into You is the more popular of her hits this year. It's got a faster tempo for one, but I vastly prefer the rock swagger of this one. The slow waltz cadence and the bombastic horns even add some show tune flair, which suits Ariana perfectly. All that you got. Which, like, sure, I wouldn't call this one of her all-time greatest performances. The verses in particular are a bit weak, but, like, it's Ariana Grande. She's still gonna put her all into every word she sings and sound fantastic doing it. I think more than anything else though, this song gets a lot of flack for its lyrics. Which, yes, Ariana is not a dangerous woman. The thing is, that's not what the song is about. It's about how being sexually open makes her feel dangerous. And like, isn't that sad? That one of the most famous women on the planet can feel apprehensive about something as basic and universal to the human experience as sex? Don't need permission, made my decision to test my limits. Real talk here, it's genuinely scary how conservative puritanism has permeated even a lot of liberal and left-wing spaces. The good old think of the children argument, where sexuality is seen as evil and gross, rhetoric which is, of course, weaponized primarily against sex workers and LGBT folk. Yet, it remains the mainstream perception towards sex, creating a hypersexualized society that's paradoxically terrified of sex. And if I, an asexual person, can recognize this as a problem, why the hell can't everyone else? Anyways, guitar solo! Yeah, it's a difficult conversation to have. One that I'm honestly not capable of diving deeper into myself. And hell, even if you prefer Into You, it still has shades of these same themes too. Thankfully, we do seem to be moving in the right direction regarding the mainstream perception of sexuality, so there's at least progress being made. And while Dangerous Woman may not be the one asking the hard questions, like with Mama's Broken Heart, it at least implies them in a way that my mind can't help but follow through on. Between that and just how damn great the song itself is, yeah, it's easily one of Ariana's best. Number 4. Taylor Swift did not have any New Year in hits in 2016, but her shadow loomed over the year regardless. Kanye West Famous set in motion the chain of events that led to the release of Reputation in late 2017. Calvin Harris handed off a song Taylor had penned to Rihanna for her most pointless hit of the decade, and barely scraping onto the year end was a response song to one of Taylor's best hits, and it was, well, damn near perfect. But if you like causing trouble, perfect is basically just style again, at least the chorus is. Similar lyrical cadences, similar if not identical chord progressions. Even the title drop is handled similarly in both. And by sheer coincidence, both it and style ended up at number 4 on their respective best lists. Though really, the similarities pretty much end there. These are still fundamentally different songs. When I first saw you from across the... Honestly, this song placing this high surprised even me, as it's got the most obvious flaws out of any song here. By far the worst production, especially the unfitting percussion, some shaky vocal performances not even really making sense as a boy band song, and arguably its best aspects are stolen from another song, but despite all that, I still love it to death. It's just, man, there's something beautiful about it. I might never be knight in shining armor. Like, you'd think that with a song about how One Direction, or more specifically Harry, is an unreliable screw-up of a partner, it'd be hard to look good after that. But man, there's an earnestness to it all, a willingness to own up to all his imperfections that makes it work. In particular, I love how the instrumentation cuts out in the chorus to let the song deliver its big wham line. Baby, I'm perfect. Baby, I'm perfect for you. And if you like, that's it. That's the core of the song. I'm not perfect, but I'm perfect for you. I can't promise a deeper love, I can't promise commitment, but I can promise a good time. Be it private conversations or traveling the world together, living out your wildest dreams. It's about living in the moment, making lasting memories, knowing that someday that moment will pass. There's a sense of transience to it, like there is with all things in life, and that's where it really connects with me. If you're looking for someone to write your breakup songs about, baby, I'm perfect. And the bridge, a direct reference to style, also serves as the closing of a chapter. The time they spend together, the memories they make, will have an end, did have an end, yet he can still look back on the memories they made together and cherish them. It's the end credits song to the movie they made together, bittersweet but ultimately peaceful. And considering I have a history of really liking these kind of songs, yeah, it's not hard to see why this one won me over. And as the end credits song for One Direction themselves, I can't imagine a more perfect song to go out on. Baby, I'm perfect. Number 3. I avoided bringing it up earlier specifically because I was saving this for now, but as much as I do love Let It Go, there is one line I take issue with. Let the ashes fall, forget about me. James, my man, you and I both know that ain't gonna happen. Every year, there seems to be at least one of these. A song that's not particularly deep and doesn't give me much to talk about, but just sounds too damn phenomenal for me to deny. The sparkling, colorful synths, the lush atmosphere, the propulsive energy of the percussion, damn near flawless. Pure ear candy. Both performers here sound great on their own, but especially together. And while Zara may be the technically better singer, MNEK has the best solo moment of the song, so... And in stark contrast to the pessimism of Let It Go, Never Forget You is bright, optimistic, and genuinely heartfelt, yet not saccharine. What they had together couldn't last forever, and they understood they needed to move on. Yet, their feelings for each other haven't faded, and they still look back upon the memories they made with nostalgic joy rather than bitter regret. And frankly, that optimism must be infectious, cause if I looked at this song with even the tiniest bit of cynicism, I'd call it the most flawed song on this list, and for one reason alone. You take all that wonderful buildup and just squander it with this anticlimactic, underweight, percussion-heavy drop. I don't get it. And this happens twice in the song too. The weirdest thing is, the beat itself actually rules. Played under the verse and chorus, it gives both way more energy and life, transforming the song into a completely different beast. But it absolutely is not a satisfying payoff on its own. Of course, like I said, that doesn't really matter. I don't treat music as a zero-sum game, especially when the song also has the best moment of the entire year. The bridge and final chorus are just, holy hell man, absolutely breathtaking. The slow build from just their lonely voices to a glorious kaleidoscope of sound. Nothing else this year comes even remotely close to the way this song gets my heart racing. Just those 50 seconds of music alone are more than enough to make it one of my favorites of the year, regardless of anything and everything else the song has to offer. And And even when the drop hits and underwhelms again, I hardly care. I've already reached Nirvana. Nothing can bring me down. Though both Zara and MNEK wailing passionately over the last drop certainly helps to sell it as a big finale anyways. Never Forget You is basically the antithesis to everything that 2016 was. It's loud, it's upbeat, and it's unshakably hopeful. It's a beacon of light in the midst of a world of darkness, and I doubt I'll ever forget it. Number 2. This is the end of the song, and it is just a song. This is a version of me and you that can exist outside of everything else. And if it is just a fantasy, then anything can happen from here. The contract is up. The names have been changed. So pour one out, whoever you are. These are only lyrics now. Will Toledo, Car Seat Headrest, 2018. And also, in spirit at least, Adele Lori Blue Adkins, 2016. Let me photograph you in this light in case it is the last time. Moving on is difficult. It takes time, it takes effort, and you can't ever truly move past the experiences that made you who you are today. Adele, of all people, would know this. I mean, she wrote an entire album trashing her ex that just screamed of not over it. And 4 years later, more than enough time for her wounds to heal, she reconnects with that same old flame at a party, catching her off guard and bringing all those buried memories and emotions rushing back to her. And I swear you moved overseas. Yet, at the same time, she knows there's no chance of returning to what they had together. Too much time has passed. They're too much older now than the people who loved each other 4 years ago. Their youth is gone forever. The most they can do is reconnect, capture that moment in a photograph, and move on. More than anything, what this song serves as is closure. It's hard to win. Like with Perfect, When We Were Young is a prime example of an end credits song, the closing of a chapter in their lives. Both of them will leave the party, and they may never see each other again, and that will be fine. There's nothing more to their story anyways, and the thing is, none of this actually happened. It's all just a fantasy. It's only a song. These are only lyrics. But they serve as a way for Adele to move on her own terms. Anything can happen from here. It hardly matters that this is just a beautifully composed song where one of the best vocalists of our generation sells the emotion of every line perfectly. I mean, it helps, but that's not what makes the song what it is. It's just an immensely powerful emotional gut punch. I can see why many call it their favorite Adele song. Hell, it's Adele's favorite Adele song. And while I can't quite say the same, yeah, it's undeniably one of the most beautiful, heartbreaking, and yet nonetheless comforting songs of the decade. It was just like a song when we were young. And now it's time for some serious tonal whiplash as we goof off with some honorable mentions. The concept is great, the song delivers on that concept flawlessly, yet I just can't quite get into the actual sound of the song. I don't know, it's kind of a weird, formless mess. Consider this a surrogate entry for the entire album, which really deserved to have more hits. Don't Hurt Yourself is probably my favorite of the bunch, because of course it is, but 6 Inch and Daddy Lessons are real good too. I love how wonderfully dark and intense the production is, and the beat switch towards the end is goddamn inspired. But it's a bit too repetitive and a bit too long, and considering the Scots took the same formula while solving both of these problems only a few years later, yeah, not much reason for me to return to this one. God, this song is mid-2000s edge personified in all the worst ways, and you cannot convince me it's about anything other than the Edgelord movie it soundtracked. By far 21 Pilots' worst written hit, and by far their best sounding too, thus making it my favorite of the three. What can I say? It's delightfully dark and catchy as all hell. Good stuff. I'm only human, can't you say? I made a mistake. honestly, this song's really only here for one thing, and it's the only thing I'm ever actually paying attention to when I listen to it. The weird, janky, glitchy percussion. Now I'm fucked up, and I'm missing you. I mean, Kai has a nice voice, there's some nice production work here, and some not so nice production, but man, I just love that percussion. It's so fun to follow. I mean, yeah, I still really like this one too. I just like Dangerous Woman more, that's all. I get that this song's basically the antithesis to everything that When We Were Young stands for, but I think it's perfectly normal for both of those emotions to coexist. And it's just a pretty damn fun song regardless. Yeah, not her best, but still pretty good. Once I was 20 years old, my story got told. This song is fascinating. 7 Years is a bad Lucas Graham fanfiction written by Lucas the Graham that goes off on a dozen unrelated tangents, has a weird and unsettling fixation on self-worth, specifically through having and raising children. And Lucas the Graham himself sings like he's a rock god on top of this twinkly music box production that absolutely does not deserve any of the bombast it has. It's kind of charming. I like it. Lucas the Graham seems completely delusional, but at the very least, I believe he believes every word he's singing. This song gets a lot of crap, and yet I've never heard any explanation beyond that people don't like how it sounds. Which is fine, taste and all that. Personally, I love how it sounds. For about 30 seconds. The intro and outro are by far the best parts of this song because, yeah, that percussion is too loud. That clicking noise is one of the strangest production choices I've ever heard. Way too much of this song is chorus. And the lyrics are kinda lousy. I still like the rest of the song, just not as much as those first 30 seconds. I almost tied the two Coldplay songs so I could put this on the list proper and give it a full segment, so consider this the honorary number 11. The approach Golding takes in a response to Sheeran is interesting. More confusion and lingering regret than anything. And the manic, jittery production is a great fit for it. And it's weirdly fun too. But yeah, this is not the best way to use your Golding, and it can be a bit grating at times, so I don't feel too bad about leaving it off the list proper. And another reason why I didn't give it a full segment is, well, I think it's so cute and I think it's so sweet. Oh god, am I really gonna be the one to defend this? No, this is not a joke. No, this is not a bait and switch. I like this song. I'm as surprised as anyone, but yeah, this kinda slaps. First you gonna say you ain't running game, thinking I believe in. Like, this isn't the first time I've liked the Meghan Trainor song, and it's not as good either, but it's still low-key one hell of a bop. The late 90s, early 2000s pop pastiche feels spot on, Meghan's rarely sounded better, and it's just one hell of a fun kiss-off anthem. All my ladies, listen up, if that boy ain't giving up. A kiss off to a guy she doesn't even know. And I feel like the attitude towards this song stems mostly from the opening lines, which. But let me stop you there, oh, before you speak. I understand why this could seem harsh. Maybe that guy didn't mean anything by it. I mean, she didn't even let him talk. But like, y'all, this ain't her first rodeo. Probably won't be her last either. And if you read literally any lyric in the verses, it's clear that, yes, this guy was trying to hit on her. So it's not like she was wrong to make that assumption. And anyways, it's not like she owes him her time either. I was in my zone before you came along. Don't want you to take this. She's not there for a hookup. She's there to hang out with her friends and have a good time, and this guy just interrupts her to try and get in her pants. Frankly, I think she's being a bit too nice, and it's not like her initial comment stopped him from running his mouth anyways. Like, let's say for the sake of argument that the other guy is Lee Bryce. You one of them girls that ain't trying to meet nobody. This really does just feel like one of them girls from the woman's perspective instead. Which, considering my distaste for that song, yeah, might be why this one connects for me. You go, girl. Tell him straight up and don't take no for an answer back. And yet, the song doesn't quite work either, and it all comes down to that chorus.
My name is no, my sign is no, my number is no, you need to let it go.
Like, what the hell is this? For one, it sounds like garbage, and it has no reason at all to either, considering the later choruses sound pretty damn good.
My name is no, my sign is no, my number is no, you need to let it go.
Like, why would you do that to your own song? God. But the bigger issue is that, well, you can tell that Megan doesn't quite grasp the issue. She naively believes a simple no is all she needs, but sadly, the real world doesn't work like that. It's way, way too common for consent to be outright ignored if a man isn't getting what he wants, and no amount of words are gonna stop him from trying, possibly by force. At which point, you need to whip out a can of pepper spray and blast him straight in the eyes. So yeah, this song is so damn close to working, but it doesn't quite get there. Despite that, I still respect the attempt and the attitude, and it's still a pretty damn fun jam, even with its flaws. So I say yes to no. Me too still sucks though. No revisionism on that one, please. Anyways, as a palate cleanser, here's a short list of 2015 repeats I still love. I only caught you in. The Weeknd's signature song, or at least it was until Blinding Lights took over. Honestly, I still think it is. Not my personal favorite, sure, but the song that's both the most representative of him as an artist while also massively popular. His Thriller, if you will. This is basically Taylor's When We Were Young, and it's every bit as good as that comparison implies. So speaking of Adele, this probably wouldn't make my 2015 best list if I made it now, and it's still great. Funny that. I'll be over here. Oh, yeah. Oh. Hey, remember that time that me and Ben Eels both independently came to the realization that this song was about social anxiety? When I see And if I made my 2015 best list now, this would be top 3 on it. It'd be top 3 here too, just behind Adele. God, I'm such a sucker for end credits songs. And on the subject of ending things, yeah, let's close this chapter for good. Look what you done. Number 1. Wait, no, go back! I had such a good preamble for this one, too. Well, anyways, surprise! Is it in poor taste to use your number one as the bumper music? Maybe? I've honestly always wanted to do that, though. Anyways. Ooh, I know a sad soul. I Took a Pill in Ibiza seems to be the definitive famous and miserable anthem of the year for a lot of people. But for me, Starboy has always filled that role better. Mike Posner sings mostly about what he used to have and how it led to him being miserable when he was no longer famous. Everything he had, money, girls, cars, drugs, The Weeknd now has, and having them still doesn't make him the least bit happy. Look what you've done indeed. House so empty, need a centerpiece. 20 racks a table cut from ebony. Though, the song does a lot to hide its true colors. It starts off toying with your emotions with several bait and switch moments throughout the first minute. Oh, that's ominous. Huh, I don't know what I was afraid of. This is one hell of a groove. Time to get down and have some fun and... I'm trying to put you in the worst mood, cleaner than your church shoes. Oh, those chords are anything but fun. House so empty, need a centerpiece. 20 racks a table cut from ebony. Actually, wait, I think I got it. Luxury rap with a darker sound was all the rage in 2016. Abel's probably just going for something similar here. Switch on my core if I kill any pain. Are you okay, Abel? Look what you got. Oh no, not okay. And the moment that realization smacks you over the head, so too does the percussion. God, best 2 seconds of the year. It hits so damn hard. Yeah, even as much as I love the content, like with a lot of other songs here, I love the sound of the song more than anything else. Starboy has the best production of the year. That's why it's my number one. And I mean, you get Daft Punk to produce for you, of course it rules. Let a nigga bracket, legend of the fall, took the year like a bandit. There's just this undercurrent of dread throughout the song. Like at any moment, something could go terribly wrong. Maybe it already has, and you just haven't realized it yet. I get chills every time I hear those robot vocals on the chorus. An unmistakably Daft Punk touch that perfectly complements The Weeknd's trademark darker sound. And yet, despite that air of lurking horror, the song's still fun as hell. Yeah, pull up in the roadster. Like I said it before, but this groove rules. It takes that haunting atmosphere and makes it accessible, makes it danceable, makes it fun. In that way, it feels like the perfect capstone for a year as gloomy and dread-filled as 2016. It takes everything that defined the year's music and flips it on its head. I mean, hell, if you're gonna go down burning like a star, you might as well have the time of your life doing it, right? I'm a motherfucking star boy. Starboy wasn't The Weeknd's first hit, it certainly wasn't his last, and he's grown into his fame over the years, but as ironic as it may be, Starboy was the first time The Weeknd truly felt like a world-conquering superstar. It damn well may be his best song to date. Look what you've done, Abel. You've made me proud to call Starboy the best hit song of 2016. I'm a motherfucking star boy.